It's showtime.
Okay, Tokyo, South America, Australia, France, Germany, UK, Africa.
Here we go. Head on with Bob Kincaid. 3 hours of conversation cussing and a discussing with America's only born and bred Southern liberal talk host. Head on with Bob Kincaid is brought to you each night by Coal River Mountain Watch. Coal River Mountain Watch invites you to become part of the solution, part of a sustainable future, part of the uprising against mountaintop removal. Coal River Mountain Watch, crmw.net. And now, from high in the hills of beautiful West Bicod, Virginia, here's Bob Kincaid on the Head On Radio Network.
Well, howdy. And here we go, off and running, for the middle of the week. Yes. It is Boxing Day in Canada, the UK, Australia. Y'all do Boxing Day, don't you? We don't, but long, long ago, it would be, I guess, 1995, 23 years ago, a dear friend of mine who was a native of a native of England who had moved here with her husband, she married an American, referred to Ferg as my Boxing Day baby. And so that's, well, it's Ferg's birthday. 23 years. Happy birthday, my son. Happy birthday. It's also Sparky's stepson's birthday, so happy birthday to him as well. And, the day after Christmas. And the madness continues apace. Thank you very kindly, Brother Deacon Asa. Loud and clear from the pulpit at the Cathedral of Common Sense. Remember, kids, the moon landing was staged, but Trump visiting the troops in the Iraq, such as, wasn't. Well played, sir. Well played, indeed. Hi, I'm Bob Kincaid, and the first thing we do on every broadcast is to extend thanks. We have three subscribers for the 26th day of the month. Thank you very kindly to Peter, and thanks as well to Michael in Madison, and thank you to Milton. Thank you, Milton, very kindly as well. And big thanks... big thanks also going out to Joanne. Joanne in New York. Thank you, Joanne. Thank you very, very kindly. That was unlooked for and a beautiful bit of help for the end of the month. Thank you, Joanne, very kindly. I am informed by Darlene in Connecticut. That's two tins of Palmans that have arrived by now. Darlene got hers, and she confirms, Darlene confirms how wonderful the Palmans are. You know, if they weren't so darn labor-intensive, I think this could be a thing for our buddy Paul from Parts Unknown. But Darlene said, my Palmans arrived Christmas Eve and are delightful. Nicely packaged, too. Thank you, Paul from Parts Unknown, and to the horn. I can't believe I lucked out this year and got a batch. And you're right, Bob. They're like potato chips. You can't have just one. Thanks again. I'm so glad you're enjoying them, Darlene, and I love that people share that assessment. How could something so simple be so unutterably delicious? So, let's see. We're still looking for our buddy John Brittavoe to get his tin. And Chris in Germany should be receiving hers. And I forget who Who got the other one? Mike in Cascadia. Mike in Cascadia. So let me know, Mike, and, by all means, John, too, and Chris. Chris has had them before, so she knows how good they are. But it's become a lovely little holiday tradition, and thanks most of all to Paul from Parts Unknown for the labor-intensive work that he does to that results in the Paulmans. It's wonderful. Of course, I would note this 26th day of December is, of course, it's a Wednesday, and Wednesdays here are far more than just the middle of the week or hump day or downhill to Friday. No, brethren and sistren, Wednesdays here are prayer meeting Wednesday, when the faithful gather for a little prayer and Bible study and whatnot, just like they do all over America at places that your Baptist gospel chop shops and your Pentecostal gospel chop shops and your Apostolic gospel chop shops and what have you. It's prayer meeting Wednesday. And, of course, knowing that we're at the end of the year and, little old blue-haired ladies like to keep up with the holiday calendar. They asked me, since they knew that the deacons wouldn't have to be doing any heavy lifting this week, the deacons aren't going to be passing the plate this evening, they asked me if I'd get the little old blue-haired men together, some of whom are deacons, and go out and fire up the cathedral's acorns, and prepare a batch of corned beef and cabbage. They wanted a New Year's meal a week early, because New Year's Day, of course, will be Tuesday this coming. And so we did. Me and the little old blue-haired men went out and built the fire. We had previously brined and seasoned the briskets. And yes, indeed. So for everybody who was gathered there in the fellowship hall this evening down in the basement of the cathedral, there was an early New Year's dinner. Corned beef and cabbage, hickory smoked and slow roasted, juicy and wonderful. And all the other New Year's Day trimmings. There was cornbread, of course. Can't have corned beef and cabbage without cornbread. Not in Appalachia, you can't. And then there were some black-eyed peas with rice and Hoppin' John. And, of course, a great big simmering cauldron of turnip greens. Oh, nothing like it. Nothing like it at all. And then dessert-wise, several big old snow white coconut layer cakes. And the deacons, knowing that they were going to be able to largely remain idle this evening, the deacons, they went after that stuff with a will. There was not a fleck of coconut remaining, brethren and sistren, not a fleck. So then they trundled their massive bulk upstairs, because even when they don't have to work, they still want to get in a little chain smoking before the sermon begins, lest they nod off and get hit with the squirt bottle that I keep here right under the rostrum, right under the podium. And after a while, cigarette number four, they saw Sister Carol Baker waving the solar-powered cattle prod, and they blazed, deacon speed, that is. They blazed past her, lumbered past her, the deacons did, and past that desiccating bowl of butter mints, and came on down here and down front and just sat down insolently, I will tell you. They insolently sat down and just plopped their massive bulks on the front row. The deacons get the front row, of course, and didn't even glance over to those big old brass-bound, velvet-lined collection plates, because they knew they weren't going to be passing them, and they're not. But just the same, we will invite the Minister of Music forward to lead us in the traditional prayer meeting Wednesday, opening hymn. Brother Minister of Music, if you would, please.
And he said, it's time for you to leave behind the things of this world. The fine houses, the fancy cars, the flashy clothes, because we are all naked in the eyes of the Lord.
Stop! This man is clinically insane!
Ladies and gentlemen, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, let me hear you say, Amen!
Amen!
Let me hear you say, Praise the Lord!
Praise the Lord!
Let me hear you say, I will empty the contents of my wallet into that little collection plate when it comes around!
I will empty the contents of my wallet into that little collection plate when it comes around!
And it's all tax-free. Hallelujah! Praise the Lord for all the cash I've got. Praise Him for my Rolls Royce and my yacht. Serving God ain't hard with a credit card. Jesus died so I could make a lot. Praise the Lord, He's made us millionaires. Wave your donations in the air. We've replaced our hymns with ATMs, and soon we'll charge a fee on every prayer. Jesus Christ was a poor man, don't you know? He should have used our accountants for his cash flow. Stop the Sermon on the Mount, he should have had a bank account. 2,000 years with interest, he'd be rolling in the dough. Praise the Lord, this song's out on CD, just $40.95 plus GST. Hallelujah, plenty of moolah, solid gold baubles on my Christmas tree. I've got all of heaven's riches, thanks to all you stupid bitches. Praise the Lord for modern Christianity. Whoever said religion should be free?
Oh, Hutsut Ralston on the Rillera and the Brawler Brawlsuit. I love you. Welcome, brethren and sistren, to Prayer Meeting Wednesday on the Horn. I'm a-calling upon you right now. Amen. Glory. Praise Jesus. I'm a-calling upon you right now to get up off of your seats and stand up onto your amen feet and wiggle and waggle and waddle between the pews, amen, and move without rhythm so you won't attract the worms, hallelujah, and come on down that blood red aisle and fall, brethren and sisters, upon your knees before the altar and lay your hands, amen, glory, upon the subwoofer, and feel the healing rays of common sense a-flowing through you from the amen server on high. I am Archpope, Uber Rabbi, Ultimate Imam, Animated Animist, Antagonized, Agnostic, Vicarious Vicar, Maximum Metropolitan, Ponerized Pontiff, Munificent Mufti Bob Kincaid. And this here is Prayer Meeting Wednesday from the Cathedral of Common Sense. Amen and amen. We begin prayer meeting this evening with a dispatch from God's own anointed Secretary of the Department of Homeland Security. Amen. Glory. Kirsten Nielsen is a fine, God-fearing, upstanding, Bible-believing, Christ-centered, evangelical, fundamentalist, amosexual Christian, anointed by the Lord to make sure that none of them filthy, heathen, often Mary-worshipping Mexicans and Guatemalans and Hondurans and El Salvadorians and whatnot get through our southern border here and take up residence in our sacred white country. Jesus, land, amen. God's own Secretary of Homeland Security done said the following, amen. In the evening hours of December 24th, it's curious she doesn't bother to mention that it was Christmas Eve. Maybe she ain't so good and God-fearing after all, brethren and sistren. Why didn't she say it was Christmas Eve? What are the folks at War on Christmas headquarters going to think of her for not mentioning the eve of our Savior's birthday? Amen and amen. In the evening hours of December the 24th, a child what had been apprehended with his father by the Border Patrol attempting to illegally enter the new United States of America, the greatest country in the history of the world on earth, now, today, forever in the universe, under God, died at an El Paso hospital after being taken for emergency treatment for the hope glory second time in less than 12 hours. That little kid got a trip to the hospital twice in 12 hours. This tragedy, she says, the death of a child in government custody, is deeply concerning and heartbreaking. In the last 24 hours, I have directed a series of additional actions to care for those who enter our custody. And then she goes on, brethren and sistren, to explain why it is that we seem to have this problem now of letting little children in government custody get all dead. You know whose fault it is? Well, here's a hint. It ain't Kirsten Nielsen's fault, and she wants y'all to know that and quit saying that. And it ain't Donald Trump's fault, because he's just making America great again, one dead Guatemalan baby at a time. That's right. She says, in recent months, we have seen a dramatic increase at the border of families and unaccompanied children crossing our border illegally. Now, of course, she speaks with the tongue of a serpent there, because it is not illegal to enter the United States for purposes of seeking asylum. There's not even anything remotely illegal about it. Crossing the border illegally is something that happens because she and her boss have made it nearly impossible to cross the border at legal points of entry. So they've made it illegal by doing something illegal. Yeah, you understand here? Yeah. But she's a good God-fearing woman, Kirsten Nielsen is. Oh, she loves her some Jesus. She does, she does. This here change in dynamic is the direct result of obvious draw factors. An immigration system that rewards parents for sending their children across the border alone. A system that prevents parents who bring their children on a dangerous and illegal journey from facing consequences for their actions, like maybe being taken out and shot or something. I mean, I bet you if they found out we was rounding them up and taking them out and putting them against the wall and shooting them all, by golly, I tell you what, praise Jesus, I bet you that'd cut down on the immigration a long ways, don't you? And we could go on saying we's a Christian nation the whole time. How about that now? Mm-hmm. There's an asylum process that's not able to quickly help those who qualify for asylum. And, of course, the things that you can qualify for asylum for are getting fewer and fewer and fewer with every passing day that Julius Geezer is in the White House, you understand. and of course, it's unfair to lay this all off on the likes of Kirsten Nielsen and Julius Geezer, because let's not forget Hare Miller, Stephen Miller, and that's H-A-I-R, not H-E-R-R. Him with the spray on dew there, because he's the architect of most of this hatred. And she goes on and says that our system has been pushed to a breaking point by those who seek open borders. Well, I don't know who those people are. I have yet to hear anybody advocate for open borders. There are some of us, however, who have enough historical and anthropological information before us to talk about the fact that people have been moving up and down these continents in this here hemisphere for about as long as they've been here. That's just fact. And she says, it's been more than a decade since CBP has had a child pass away in their custody. It's now clear that migrants, particularly children, are increasingly facing medical challenges and harboring illness caused by their long and dangerous journey. It's their fault. It's their fault that they're sick. In response to the unprecedented surge of children into our custody, I have directed a series of extraordinary protective measures. I personally engaged with the Centers for Disease Control to request that their experts investigate the uptick in sick children crossing our borders and identify the additional steps hospitals along the border should be undertaken to prepare for and to treat these here children. At my direction, all children in Border Patrol custody have been given a thorough medical screening. Moving forward, all children will receive a more thorough hands-on assessment. Oh, dear. It's that hands-on thing. At the earliest possible time post-apprehension, whether or not the accompanying adult has asked for one. I've also spoken with our partners in Mexico to ask that they begin to investigate the causes of these illnesses on their side of the border, and to provide medical assistance in shelters as needed. Well, so, all told, Kirsten Nielsen once again blames the parents. And, along the way, blames the children themselves in her own way. Blames Mexico, and, you know, but, of course, nothing she or her department did in any way contributed to the demise of a little 8-year-old Felipe, I believe his name was. No? Yeah. But because I pay attention to the broader spectrum of cause and effect, and understand I'm not going anywhere near Alex Jones's corner, and I'm not going to be talking about monkey jellyfish hybrids that you can buy in the bazaars of old Hong Kong or anything like that, no. But, you know, it's customary this time of year in media. You'll be seeing more and more of them. Year-end retrospectives. Just earlier today, I heard that, I heard a story on National Petroleum Radio all about how things that were published in 1923 enter the public domain this year. One of those happens to be Robert Frost's Stopping by the Woods on a Snowy Evening. That will enter the public domain. Meaning that folks can read from it or share it and not have to worry about paying people who never had a damn thing to do with the talent of Robert Frost for the right to reference Robert Frost's poetry. Robert Frost being all, you know, dead for, oh, like 57 years or so. All right. But that being the case, I found it interesting that I have seen little to no mention of the fact that the coming year, 2019, and in particular November 2019, will mark the 500th anniversary of the arrival of and invasion by Hernan Cortes in what we now know as Mexico, named for the Mexica people, who were the dominant force in the region, although there were a lot of other city-state sort of entities. And I mention this for a reason, because something dawned on me last night. When things like this 8-year-old little boy's death happen, we can't help but ask why. I don't think it is improper to ask why. And so here's the question. Well, no, here's the setup. 499 years ago, a group of Spaniards, and what's the term Trump used? Spain did not send their best to the New World. Highwaymen, cut purses, murderers, thieves, rapists. A lot of people lit out for the so-called New World for a chance to escape the old, as well as a chance to find their fortune. They were, and this is not, I mean, it's not complicated, it just takes a minute to to sort through. European peoples and Asiatic peoples, well, the domestication of animals begins in roughly the same area that agriculture arises in. In the texts, it's referred to as the Fertile Crescent, and you can read about early farming communities like Çatalhöyük, and, you know, down into the Levant there, the Jericho and whatnot. And the rise of city-states, semi-empires based on agriculture in Mesopotamia, a Greek term that means the land between the rivers. The rivers in this question being the Tigris and the Euphrates. And by virtue of domesticating animals, these people began to experience evolution even before anyone knew what evolution was. Because pathogens that were carried by the animals that were domesticated began to mutate and evolve until they could affect the human population. Measles, smallpox, chickenpox, cowpox, anthrax, mumps, on and on and on. Most of these, if not all of them, are diseases that came about because human beings lived in close contact with their domesticated animals. Well, at the same time, over on the other side of the world, there were civilizations arising and cultures developing in which there was very little animal domestication. A, because this hemisphere was a rich, rich, rich world in terms of game on the hoof. And, you know, why bother feeding and taking care of animals if they can do it all on their own, just living in the forests that you've managed so that they yield massive quantities of acorns and hickory nuts and black walnuts and things such as that. The turkeys eat it, the deer eat it, the buffalo that moved all the way across the continent at one time eat the grass and the scrub. The air is filled with pigeons and ducks. The waters, the clean waters, are full of all manner of fish, and shellfish. The verges of the seaside provide massive amounts of seaborne life. So there's not a lot of call. Did you ever try to domesticate a buffalo? It's not a fun activity. And it annoys the buffalo and will probably get you hurt. This was one of those lessons that some of the people that lived on this side of the world learned. And why bother? They were doing pretty well by themselves, and there was plenty for everybody. To a certain extent, the people who lived in the Andes did manage to domesticate the llama. But I don't care how much you domesticate a llama. They're still not particularly nice animals. Not very friendly. They have something on the order of a similar disposition to that of a camel. I'm trying to point out the difference between the two cultures that eventually came to clash. The people on this side had developed no immunities. They didn't need to any animal-borne diseases. And so when the Spaniards got here, 500 years ago, 499 years ago as we speak, 500 years ago in November of 2019, the indigenous peoples who lived here began to drop like flies. And that's saying like flies is no insult to the indigenous people, but it was the most massive genocide this world has probably ever known. Tens upon tens of millions of people in an otherwise reasonably densely populated hemisphere died. Some people died of white European diseases before they ever set eyes on a white man. The diseases simply outpaced the white people. That was 500 years ago. And yet, especially in places like Mexico, Guatemala, Honduras, El Salvador, Nicaragua, Costa Rica, Panama, and certainly down into South America with Bolivia, Peru, Ecuador, parts of Colombia, there remain indigenous people whose contact with white European culture is limited at best. Now, by way of making some sense of this story, I'm going to suggest that we veer off on a bit of a tangent. You remember a few weeks back when, because this is Prayer Meeting Wednesday, we can talk about these sorts of things. You remember a few weeks back when that intensely privileged missionary who decided that the people in the, what was the name of that island group there in the Indian Ocean? Well, they hadn't had much contact with modern humans. And he decided that no matter how many tens of thousands of years they'd been successfully living on those islands, he, through the miracle of his own privilege, needed to go and tell them all about Jebus, so that those people who had been living and dying for tens upon tens of thousands of years without benefit of Christianity could stop having to go to hell when they die. And so he was going to go and wave a Bible at him and tell him Jesus loved him. And as soon as he got within arrow range, they pincushioned his ass and killed him dead. He kind of had it coming. But the other part of the story is that it took India, because these islands fall under the jurisdiction of India, it took the Indian government a long time to come around to the idea, but they finally did. And they specifically declared that contact with these peoples was flat out illegal. Leave them alone. It is a punishable crime to even try to have contact with them. Why? Well, not because they had a tendency to pincushion anybody who got near them, but because they had had such limited contact with people from the so-called outside world that the merest contact could prove to be a disease vector for something that doesn't even bother us, but could prove to be genocidal to them. One sniffle, one cough, one sneeze, one scratch, one dump taken in the sand. And that could be the end of that culture. And that's the right way to approach a situation such as this. South American nations like Brazil nominally have similar laws on the books saying that uncontacted people must be left alone by the descendants of the colonizing white Europeans. And when the Spaniards arrived 499 years ago in Mexico, God, they were crawling with disease. Good God, measles, mumps, chicken pox, smallpox. And when it got hold, remember, 500 years ago in 1518, Tenochtitlan was the largest city on earth. Probably larger than Paris, London, Rome, Venice, and Constantinople combined. But here's the wild part. It was also the cleanest city. It sat on an island in a large but reasonably shallow lake. Water, fresh water, was brought via aqueduct from nearby mountain springs. They had running water. And when the filthy, ignorant Spanish saw this, they were amazed and wondered, what sort of deviltry is this, where a man can go into a closet and relieve himself and twist a knob and it all just goes away? What demons must make this work? Holy Mother Church must put an end to this indoor plumbing! You think I exaggerate? I do not. But even Cortez himself said it was the most beautiful city he had ever seen in the world. And within 10 to 15 years, the most beautiful, most populous city in the world had been reduced to a ruin. And gone was the indoor plumbing. And gone was the reliable fresh water. But Gone Too was a shocking proportion of the people who had actually lived there, because they had been killed by not so much the guns or the swords, but by the diseases, which were the Spaniards' secret weapon. You do not have to believe a word I'm saying. Everything I'm mentioning is historically verifiable. So let's flash forward for 499 years. The people who are leaving Guatemala, who are fleeing the violence there, the whole country is eaten up by violence. But the people who are leaving, in many instances, for instance, the young girl who died a couple of weeks back, her first language wasn't Spanish. It was a dialect of Mayan. The same Mayan language in which are written the stelae at places like Palenque and Tikal and Chichen Itza. They pick up Spanish later. They have very limited contact in those deep highland regions because Guatemala was one of the last places that the Spaniards tried to conquer, and they never really particularly fully succeeded. And so those languages survived, and so too do other languages to this day in Mexico. The original tongue of the Mexica, Nahuatl, or Otomi. The language of the Purimpecha people. Those languages exist in far greater numbers than most of the North American indigenous languages because, well, frankly, the English proved to be much better at genocide than the Spanish ever thought to be. But please trust me, I'm getting to a point. Last night, as I continued to think about the young boy dying in American punitive custody and bound for one of our kiddie concentration camps, something just itched inside my brain. I'm not a doctor, and I don't play one on the radio. But what I do have is what is typically described as a classic liberal arts education. It minus the math. We know how it is with me and the math. And I kept noticing what was unsaid. We talked about this a little bit last night on the front porch. In the earliest accounts of the story about the boy's death. And it took a while to slowly filter out. But the boy was taken, apprehended, you know, a word that we use for, say, a desperate criminal on the lam. The boy and his father were apprehended on the 18th of December. As Kirsten Nielsen herself points out, he was taken for a nominal medical visit where they threw some ibuprofen and some amoxicillin at him. Let's remember, the amoxicillin's only going to work on bacteriological problems and not viruses. Right? Right. and sent him back, you know, take two and call me in the morning. Well, by later in the day, the child was running a fever and vomiting. And shortly after midnight, on Christmas Day 2018, he died. So again, I got to thinking. And it's a shame that a guy doing a radio program out on the internet is thinking about this probably more than most of the people in this godforsaken presidential regime. Because to them, Kirstjen Nielsen in her statement there can't help herself. Oh, this was heartbreaking, but it was the boy's fault. Or at least it was the boy's daddy's fault. Because, you know, they came here. Don't be outraged at me and Customs and Border Patrol. Be outraged at the people who are so desperate to survive that they're willing to walk 1,000 goddamn miles to try to get to safety. And then die when they get around the white people. I guess she just can't help herself. If the privilege that Kirstjen Nielsen carries around were visibly manifested, well, it'd be like those chains that Jacob Marley had to walk around with, all of which he had forged in life and carried then through the spirit world in Dickens's A Christmas Carol. She'd barely be able to move if the privilege that she has had actual mass. So, December 18th, he's captured. December 25th, just barely, he's dead. You may recall there when I was reading Kirstjen Nielsen's desperate attempt to evade responsibility for something for which she and her department are intensely responsible. And there's a legal moment here, too. When you take someone into your custody in this country, when you take away from them their liberty, you become civilly liable for what happens to them. Not that Kirstjen Nielsen wants anybody to really be much talking about that. You know, I'd love to hear her talk about it some more, as long as she was standing in the dock at The Hague, looking at spending the rest of her natural-born life all by herself in a prison cell. But that's neither here nor there at the moment. Remember, the 18th to the 24th. That's 6 days. So I got a little sleuthy, and I started looking around at, say, the incubation period for the common cold, and the incubation period for the flu, and various incubation periods for viral bugs. Guess what? Almost everything I looked at had an incubation period between 2 and 4 days, or 1 and 4 days, actually, with the general rule of thumb being 2 days. So that means that it is likely to a reasonable degree of medical certainty that whatever killed young Felipe killed him inside the territorial confines and as a direct and proximate result of contact with the United States. It's not that these people are carrying diseases to the U.S. The child probably would have died in Mexico had he contracted whatever it was he had in Mexico. So now we have to go back to the highlands of Guatemala and those Mayan cultures whose contact with the outside world has been as limited as it is. It's possible that had they remained there, young Felipe could have lived and lived, grown, and died an old man, and the number of white Europeans with whom he came in contact would have been significantly limited. Now, he came in contact, and his family did, and has, and you know, you got to give them credit, they're survivors. The disease vectors, the diseases, and the way they were vectored 500 years ago, somehow or another, managed not to kill his ancestors. But that is not the same thing as saying that he had onboard immunity to the various diseases that we mostly, as the heirs of white European colonialists, pay little mind to. He was likely not particular. We don't know what his immunization status was. But we do know that what he got in the United States. Yes, they walked 1,000 miles or more from Guatemala, but they did so largely with people from their own region. They aren't the dirty, diseased people. You might recall that Tucker Carlson said immigration makes America dirtier. Well, that is a flat-out goddamn lie. Even 500 years ago, the people who lived here were less prone to disease than the people who invaded them and the diseases which they carried killed so many tens of millions of them. Could he have picked something up from somebody else who was also in the captivity of Customs and Border Patrol? It cannot be ruled out. But based upon the history that we know of what happens when unimmunized, biologically defenseless people come in contact with, you know, us, there is reason to believe that that child was killed by a disease that would have meant absolutely nothing to the white folks around him. Maybe one of those Customs and Border Patrol agents breathed on him or sneezed, and the little kid walked through the miasmic, invisible cloud of various pathogens that he carried that never bothered him. This being Prayer Meeting Wednesday and all, is it the book of Ezekiel where it says there is nothing new under the sun? Well, that was not true for the people that who wrote the book of Ezekiel, who were completely flummoxed by ideas like why does it rain or what is a wheelbarrow. They knew nothing of the people who lived on this side of the world. And they took their own world and their own diseases for granted. But here we are 500 years later. And until shown otherwise, I think the best theory for why these two children died and particularly young Felipe, is because he came into contact with a pathogen for which his body was utterly defenseless. And he probably came into that contact via us, the U.S. dot, the United States, which is still so clueless about first contact issues. That it never dawned on them that we, and again, this is verifiable. We are the ones who bear the diseases, not the indigenous peoples living as far away from us as they can get. Oh, Bob, well, when they get to America, why don't more of them die? Well, one, we're talking about a child here. Two, migrant peoples tend to stay in their own communities until, because God knows the good white people don't want them, they want them working for them, not living near them. And so even in the working world, if they are, say, doing landscaping or housekeeping in a motel or something like that, their contact is still relatively, their contact with us is still relatively limited. Suffer the children, indeed. But I mention all of this because you're probably going to see news stories about it more and more as little bits of information are dribbled out to us. But being as we've got a nice round number like 500 years in front of us, it's worth remembering that the rest of the world often carries pathogens that for people with limited contact with us can prove absolutely mortal. So, I'd just like to provide a different perspective from that which is so often put out there by the millionaire for-profit media. You'll notice I've managed to talk about all of this without mentioning any space aliens or shapeshifters or time travelers or monkey jellyfish hybrids that are available for sale in the bazaars of old Hong Kong. These are just the mundane realities of the intersection between culture and history, anthropology and epidemiology. Sadly, I don't have a nutritional supplement to hustle to you or a concoction made from the seeds of olives or something that'll make your wife so skinny she'll practically disappear. All we have here is an attempt to understand an increasingly incomprehensible world. But being as how I'm sure Kirsten Nielsen is a fine Christian lady, I thought this inquiry was more than fitting for Prayer Meeting Wednesday. And that's the biggest part of the filibobster. If you want to discuss it, you're mighty welcome to. Unless you're brand new to the program, you probably know how to reach the program, but I'll go ahead and give out the information just the same in case there are any noobs out there. Hi. Listening in. By the way, if you're a right-winger, you're not welcome here. Don't call. Don't try. Go and talk to Alex Jones or something, okay? But if you'd like to engage on this topic or most any other, the direct dial numbers are 304-574-8178 or 304-640-2829. If you need us to pay the freight on the call, we'll be happy to do it. 844-843-4676. That's 844-THEHORN, THEHORN. Okay? And then, of course, from anywhere on the planet, you can always check in via Skype. My Skype contact is Bob Kincaid, B-O-B-K-I-N-C-A-I-D-H-O-R-N. Bob Kincaid Horn. Okay? Well, what else? We've got a lot. You know, lately we've been hearing from a cat by the name of Josh Bernstein. Now, until recently, I would not have known Josh Bernstein from Adam's house cat. But he's trying to make a name for himself by pumping out a boatload of hate. You might recall a couple of weeks back, he was calling for the assassination of soldiers and police. If they should ever try to take our guns. Well, apparently Josh Bernstein, Stein, don't know. I mean, E-I would be Stein, but never mind. Apparently he spends a lot of time thinking about the people he'd like to see killed. Is he a Christian? I don't know, but he certainly talks like one. He certainly engages in eliminationism, like one. But hey, before we go to old Josh, let's run over to the stress line, so we don't keep people on hold. Hey, welcome to the program.
Good evening. How you doing?
Well, how are you, Jim?
I'm here.
And well, if you're there, then I'm here. Or if you're here, then I'm there.
There is no there there. Anyway,
well, thank you so much, Alice B. Toklas, Gertrude Stein.
Gertrude Stein, thank you. I fixed a nail on that one, but you were too quick for me. Anyway, I just like to just make a few comments about the spread of some of these diseases. I mean, I think what you're basically talking about in finding out the answer to what happened to these children is basic shoe leather epidemiology. Am I right?
I mean, yeah, there are elements of epidemiology and elements of anthropology and evolution, I guess.
Well, I know that with AIDS, for example, they didn't know where in the world it came from initially. And the first efforts that were made by the CDC were by one very tiring epidemiologist who finally ran into patient zero, who was notified by his own doctor, and he cared less. His words were, I think somebody gave it to me. But nonetheless, he was like a French-Canadian steward, and he was notorious in his travels, and he traveled around a lot, and he was a rather effective vector for that disease because he did travel so much, and he was very handsome, and he was taken into, you know, a lot of people's sexual contact at the bath and stuff like that. So, I mean, you know, this, and then now we find out that how long really has AIDS been here? And that's something very important I think we need to talk about, too. And I don't know what you know about it. But
well, I know a little. I suspect you know more, Jim. But, you know, there's a common factor here, too. In the case of the little boy and the little girl who have recently died, the government response was to blame them. And, of course, if you go back to the wicked days of Ronald Reagan and our first consciousnesses of what would later become known as acquired immune deficiency syndrome and then later on as human immunodeficiency virus, HIV, well, the Republican response back then also was to blame the people who were sick. Do you see a common thread emerging?
Yeah, I do. It was blamed because they were blamed because of their lifestyle. That sort of thing. Yeah, exactly.
Well, their gayness.
Their what?
Their gayness.
Oh, gayness! I tell you, you're really loud coming through the phone. Just turn it down just a wee bit.
I can't do a whole lot with it.
That's good. That's good. But yeah, they were blamed for it because of their own sexual preference and lifestyle, things of that nature. But you know, as far as diseases are concerned, now that one they supposedly traced to a monkey somewhere in Central Africa.
That rings true.
Okay. I've often wondered about that. How were the people there eating this monkey?
You know, that part I don't know.
I just wondered how they were coming into contact with it, as to acquire. Unless the monkey would bite them.
Well, and the other thing is, it over time, the virus had to evolve and mutate sufficient to be able to survive long enough to kill a human being. I mean, there are lots of diseases that animals suffer from that, you know, humans just don't get. But when one evolves, that's where the trouble comes from.
Yeah, that's true, too. But this particular, well, AIDS was a retrovirus, which made it real hard to connect to abuse, as far as I know. But, I mean, how the monkeys contacted people and gave to them, I don't know. I've always wondered about that. However, yeah, you're going to find the CDC and all the epidemiologists and all the king's men are going to find some kind of way to, I guess, mask the fact that what killed this child was his contact with us. I mean, maybe it was the amoxicillin.
Well, you know, that kind of occurred to me because amoxicillin is, of course, an antibiotic. And
he was not in good shape when he first got it either.
Well, he was, you know, he was getting sick. But if he had some sort of an allergic reaction to the amoxicillin, frankly, that would be, and the language for this is very difficult, Jim, that would be more reassuring if he'd had some sort of anaphylactic reaction, but that doesn't sound like it.
Anaphylactic really, believe you me, it can take very, it hits very quickly. I mean, boom, you're lucky to make it three or make it five.
Right.
What has hit you, you know?
But here's what didn't happen the first time that they took the child for alleged medical treatment. They didn't run any blood. They didn't do anything more than bare minimum, not even triage, just, you know, looks like little guy's probably not, here's some antibiotics and some ibuprofen, get the hell out of here. That's not an appropriate, yeah. That's not an appropriate standard of care, especially when you're dealing with someone. I mean, even if you want to adopt the considerably racist notion that maybe the kid is bringing a disease to the United States, the wiser course of action would have been probably to isolate and test.
Well, yeah, you're right. And that is a possibility, like it or not. But I was just, who gave him this cursory medical examination?
It was some medical functionary at a hospital near Alamogordo, New Mexico.
Not an MD. Was it like one of these?
I don't know. It might have been a not a doc, a nurse practitioner or a physician's assistant. I doubt very seriously that he was seen by an MD, although I do not know the answer to that question.
Well, you know, the medical structure has become so damn complex with all these PAs and nurse practitioners and anyone before you can see an MD. It's just ridiculous in a way.
Well, in this country, Jim, it's an attempt to it's an attempt to pay people less to do the same thing roughly that doctors are doing, but for which they do not have adequate schooling. I mean, when members of my family go to the doctor, they quite often don't see an MD. They see a CNP, a certified nurse practitioner.
Right.
Which I don't care how much they talk about the training they've had. That is not the same thing as an MD or a DO.
No, they have 2 years of medical training after they get their RN. And after they have that 2 years of medical training, I don't know what the curriculum is, then they become a certified nurse practitioner, and they go up one step, and they can write prescriptions and do all kinds of things that nurses can't do. But 2 years does not seem a long enough time for somebody to be trained in medical arts to be able to do those things. But it's just like you said, ways they're creating these gateways for people, and they just don't want anybody to get into as few doctors as possible. And boy, have I seen a lot of those. But lucky I've had a little better luck with all that.
I mean, just by my own experience, it costs me north of $100 cash to see a physician or a certified nurse practitioner for about 5 minutes.
Good Lord. Now you had some type of insurance until
a couple of years back.
What did they do to take that away? I remember you were so happy to have it.
We got to the end of the year, and they sent me a notice saying, go online and re-up, and I did. And then a month later, I got a note saying, you don't have coverage anymore because you didn't re-up.
Really?
Yeah, I suspect that it's quite intentional.
Well, that's
because I went to their website. I filled everything out. I clicked send. It went away, and I thought, well, I'm done. And then a month later, fuck you.
Well, I remember when Obamacare first came in, you were talking about how difficult it was, you know, to really touch it when it was first rolled out. But you did have some care initially under Obamacare.
Yeah, I did.
You?
I did for about maybe a year and a half, 2 years.
And that was
because under the Affordable Care Act, the standards for Medicaid were expanded to cover people like me.
I remember that.
But then Republicans started messing with it and tinkering with it, and people who were opposed to it, they did everything in their power to make it harder to get, and if you had it, harder to maintain. So there's a website. I press send. Everything's fine. And, you know, they didn't say your information was insufficient or anything. They just said you never did what you actually did.
Well, you know who probably received that message from you? It was somebody that had as a contractor.
Right.
They pay shit wages. I mean, that's who basically had a lot of that stuff. And that's one of the reasons Obamacare has a difficulty getting out, is because they hired all these contractors who in turn hired a bunch of people who didn't know what the hell they were doing. And, all right, one aside from that, another subject besides the medical thing, and that is this drawdown of troops in the Middle East.
Mm-hmm.
And Trump saying he's going to bring them all back out of Syria and out of Afghanistan. Is that what he said?
Well, not all. I mean, he says we're going to get all the way out of Syria. And, of course, that's because, well, Erdogan and probably Putin told him to do that. But then with regard to Afghanistan, he said, I guess we've got roughly 14,000 people over there, and he's going to bring 7,000 home.
Well, you know, you can imagine the Republicans are real unhappy about that, because guess what? How many contractors are involved with those medical actions, and how much money is being made by those contractors?
Well, now, see, right there, Jim, there's the booby prize.
Yeah, that's the money shot.
And exactly. What's going to happen is we'll pull regular U.S. military out, and then we'll find a way to make sure that we've got even more money to spend, because contractors are more expensive than oath sworn troops. So we'll put mercenaries on the ground there instead of oath sworn soldiers.
You think we'd do that?
Hell, are you kidding? Yes, we'd do that.
I'm just worried because they realize they haven't had very good success with those people, and so maybe they might not. I don't know. But I do know this, that when they decline these medical actions and the Republicans start getting upset because a lot of their constituents are these real heavily influenced contractors, and, you know, they're really bleeding the country white in two ways. They're bleeding treasury dollars, and also they're bleeding our armed forces to stay in parts of the world. Because the thing about it is, that Pentagon general who, Mad Dog something is his name.
Mattis, he's already
said there is no military solution. And if there is no military solution, then you leave. and leave it be. Leave it alone. Take those assets that you're pissing away over there and bring it back straight to your own country.
And, of course, this is the argument that I've made since we went over there, because I'm one of those people who didn't think going in there was a good idea in the first place. I mean, like I said, I remember when Barack Obama was campaigning in 2008, and he said, we need to get out of Iraq, but Afghanistan was the right war at the right time. Well, I agreed with the former and disagreed with the latter. Because here's the thing, Jim. What you'll hear now is that by trying to withdraw from Afghanistan, we're going to lose all our gains. Well, we haven't gained anything.
We haven't gained anything that I can, as far as that they can measure.
And unless we were prepared to just say screw it, we're going to be an occupying power in Central Asia, or Southwest Asia, from now on. Then sooner or later, we're going to leave, and whether we leave tomorrow or day after tomorrow, what's going to happen is going to happen. And what's going to happen is the Chinese are going to move in, and they're going to start exploiting those natural resources, and the people who live there will shoot at the Chinese for a while.
Well, then the Russians might come back and give it a second try and say, well, we want a little bit too. They might... China and Russia are right there with those people. It doesn't take very far for them to get over there, the Ruskies or the Chinese. Whereas for us, every pound of whatever, every stitch of cloth or whatever, we have to send 14,000 miles away. And you can just imagine...
You know, that runs the price of a gallon of gas way on up.
Yeah, it does. And, of course, you can imagine these contractors. I mean, they have such inroads into the Pentagon that it's just incredible. I mean, you've got so many people who are on the pay of these guys and the money that's being spent. Even the Pentagon says, we don't need all this stuff, if you'll find some of the people, the officers there.
Right, but in the larger picture, Jim, and you have no idea how it galls me to say this, but with regard to Afghanistan, Trump is right for the wrong reasons. Sooner or later...
Well, whether he's right or not.
Sooner or later, we have to leave. But it's an entirely different kettle of fish with regard to what we were doing in and around the Syria region. As Asa just pointed out to me, in regard to Trump, remember, this is the same shitbag who allowed Erdogan's gangster thugs to come into D.C. and beat the shit out of American citizens. Trump is a fucking lickspittle for various and sundry homicidal dictators. And that's the absolute truth. That business about letting Erdogan's thugs beat up people on the streets of D.C., not even inside the embassy compound, Jim, and not a charge was filed, remains a real shit stain on the Trump administration.
Well, I definitely noted. But like I say, when Mattis said there is no military solution. You know, I have a lot of respect for Mattis.
Well, it takes a little bit of starch for somebody whose entire career has been in the military solutions business to finally admit that it's a lost cause. I mean, it's the functional equivalent of having a bag of hammers and saying there is no solution here that can be accomplished with a hammer.
Right, and we need to get out of those places, and we need to follow. We need not to be over there, period. That's it. End of story. And the money that's being spent, that's my point, is all those billions and trillions of dollars that are being spent over there fattening up these contractors And, of course, you've got the investors who invest with the contractors. Oh, they're just going to be screaming to the high heavens. And, you know, I wonder what would happen to the folks on Wall Street if all of a sudden that business ceased to exist. Wonder what would happen. What do you think?
Well, Wall Street got back its previous losses today. It had a big day. But Wall Street runs on war and bloodshed. There's has of late. There's no doubt about it that war, as they say, is good business.
Oh, it is good business. That's true. Absolutely. But you know, it's really Wall Street is the big guy who can afford to take a loss and then get it back, and then you've got some of the smaller people who invest. Well, I think perhaps and the things they want to use Wall Street for example, they want to put Social Security into it and other programs into it. Any way they can get that money into the Wall Street coffers, they'll do anything for. And I know my dad told me we were talking about stocks, and he said, son, stocks definitely have their place in our economy. But he said, you need to remember this. He said, if you've got enough money, and I'm not talking about your savings, I'm not talking about your expenses. If you've got enough money that you can afford to just drop into the sewer by mistake or whatever, then you can afford to start playing with the stock market. If you don't, you're a fool.
Yeah, I mean, or in many instances, maybe you might be just as well off going to Vegas or Atlantic City or, well, one of the many casinos that have popped up, or, you know, hell, here in West Virginia, walking into one of those little gambling dens that seem to dot every community here now.
Yeah, there are a lot of people I understand that are really getting addicted to that stuff. I mean, not to get away from what we're talking about, but I mean, I know that I've never really gambled in my life. I just don't have any interest in it. I play the lottery occasionally, but I know nothing's going to happen with that. But hell, it's just, you know, it can't pay unless you play. So there it is. But but gambling with some people is a real sickness. I know of several, and they've got some real bad problems doing that. It's just as addictive as any type of drug, I just say it. Anyway, I'm not sure if I really had a whole lot to say in this conversation tonight, but it just seems to me as though we've got some very serious problems with these individuals who are, well, when they're putting children in dogs' cages, and when you do that, and when you look at the condition they're in after they travel 1,000 miles, and then the other thing I wanted to mention tonight, and I'll get off here, is this incident where they took a busload of people out in the wilderness. And just left them. They each had a bus ride that was paid for by Uncle Sam, and then they were just left in the middle of nowhere. Now, I want to go back to 1938. You remember what's called Kristallnacht?
Oh, yes.
And that was created by the killing of von Rath, the German Third Secretary of the Paris Embassy. The shooting of that functionary was done by a young Jewish boy whose parents had been treated the exact same way. They just took them out into a swamp this is before the war started, in a part of Germany. They took his parents and a lot of people out in a bus and dropped them off where they would die.
History doesn't repeat, but it certainly rhymes.
Herschel Greenspan, that was the boy's name. And, you know, that was the reason for Kristallnacht. That was your proposed reason. But I just remember that when I heard that those people had been taken out by, taken into a rather undesirable area by a bus and just said, bye. That's a nice way to do business, isn't it? No, it's not either. That's horrible. But that's all I have to say.
Well, Jim, I appreciate the call, and I know you can't have had a particularly merry Christmas yesterday, but I hope it was tolerable.
Well, let me tell you real quickly. A friend of mine just came back from Ireland and brought me a Celtic Silver Cross, which I have won. And also, since she's taking care of patches, she put together a series of colored photographs arranged at different angles, not like a collage, but and framed it. And, of course, you know, it wasn't so bad. You know,
oh, good, good.
My sister and I don't get along anyway, so I didn't have to fight anybody about politics. And I got to see people who've been friends to me, and I've heard from people who've been friends. And so it was okay with me. Let me put it this way. I could have spent it in a lot worse places than where I am now. And I'm just thankful, you know, for what did happen. And I'm hopeful about...
Well, to that extent... To that extent, I am glad for you. Before you go, Jim, because this is the kind of thing that you can sink your teeth in, how about this for a piece of breaking news? Agnes just sent this to me. Headline, you're going to love this. Oh, okay, so you know Trump finally screwed his courage to the sticking place and went to see troops in Iraq, right? Well,
allegedly, yeah.
Yeah, allegedly.
Okay.
Headline, Donald Trump Twitter account video reveals covert U.S. Navy SEAL deployment during Iraq visit. What it boils down to is that after he allegedly left Iraq, he posted a video on his goddamn Twitter account in which he disclosed the whereabouts of a SEAL team whose whereabouts until that point in time were classified.
Well, that's not very, very smart. Not at all, because their missions are not to be talked about by anybody. I mean, that's what they do. They do stuff that nobody knows about till it's done, and they're back home. Oh, well, does it surprise you?
No.
I didn't think it. Listen,
I mean, this is the same president who gave classified information to the Russian ambassador on stuff that he'd been briefed on that wasn't supposed to go any further than him.
Well, there you go. I mean, you know, what kind of experience has this man had besides, you know, using other people's money, getting money from his family, and robbing from everybody he could rob, and not being able to borrow any more money, and because of his credit rating? And what kind of experience has he had? Other than non-experience, is what I call, he certainly doesn't have the experience to be a president and to be a person in government. And, you know, the guy to me is just stupid. I mean, he's just a shell. I mean, you know, he supposedly went to all these schools. Wonder how much money that cost the old daddy. But I don't know. Nothing this man does surprises me. Nothing. And it's got to the point now when I see breaking news, and I wish CNN would stop that shit. If it's real breaking news, then fine. But I wish they would come up with some other means of announcing just gibberish as breaking news. I don't know how you feel about that because you've worked with those people for a while. But don't you think it's just kind of silly?
Well, yeah. I mean, breaking news is something that's supposed to be kind of important.
Right.
Yeah, breaking news, Sarah Sanders tells another fucking lie. That is not breaking news. That's just a day that ends in Y.
It's just a matter of fact. It's just a matter of fact.
Right.
Well,
Jim, you have yourself a lovely evening, and hopefully we'll talk soon. If we don't before the new year, then a happy new year to you, my friend.
Well, be sure to get your share of those butt whistles that are coming out for New Year's Eve.
Oh, God. we almost made it all the way through the call, Jim.
Listen, those things really work.
They can get
somebody's attention.
We will take your word for it. No need for demonstrations of empirical data.
I'll be glad to demonstrate for you one night.
Oh, no, that's quite all right. Jim, have yourself a good evening. Yeah, oh, sure. Yeah, I'm sure. You take care of yourself now.
All right, bye.
Bye now. Somehow or another, no matter how serious he can get, Jim always finds his way over to the little corner we know as incorrigible and irrepressible. Meanwhile, we go over to the other line. Hey, welcome to the program. Thanks for waiting.
Hey, Bob. Hello from the blind. It's Dave from Delaware, Indiana.
Well, hey, Dave. How are you?
I'm doing good, brother. I'm doing real good. Went to see Mom yesterday. Because I'd gotten a call from my sister saying that if I waited until the beginning of the year, she probably wouldn't be there. We went to knock on the door. She tried to answer and fell.
Oh, no.
We got in. We got her to bed. She slept most of the day. But I did get to go in and say goodbye to her. And she was glad to see us. And my ex-wife, the beloved Christine, said if she hadn't been able to get through the door, she would have opened the window the hard way. So it was good. My brother and sister and I hung out at Mom's and had the cold ham and everything, and it went pretty well.
I'm glad it did, Dave. Pretty. I'm glad it did.
And it's like I've been telling you guys every time I write or anything, you know, hug the people you're close to because you're not going to have them around forever.
Well, that is the sad reality. That's the sad reality of our world, isn't it?
Yeah. I was calling to talk about the incarceration states of America.
Okay.
They blame these people coming in from Central and South America for escaping tyranny that we helped support. And then they try to criminalize when they're under international law, they're doing something that's perfectly legal. I have cerebral palsy, and I'm used to dealing with the medical profession. It's a depersonalization. You know, you're always considered a condition. On the government side, this idiot at Homeland Security, she's just making an excuse, making it not personal, so she can say, "Well, it's not my fault," you know, and it just irritates the hell out of me.
Well, it's also, there's lots of words we can pull out of our hat, Dave. It's evil. It's wicked. It's soulless. It's cruel. It's heartless. And along the way, probably a violation of no small number of internationally recognized legal standards and norms.
Well, we've been fighting against the International Criminal Court for decades, which is absolute nonsense. If you're going to hold other countries to account for their criminal activities, then you should be willing to stand up on your own two legs and defend yourself.
Right.
And
we have a do as we say, not as we do foreign policy.
I mean, my brother is a retired Army officer, and he was telling me over dinner last night, when Donald Trump announced, he said, I think he might be dangerous. I said, might be? You know, he was one of these never Hillary guys. I kind of expected that, being that where I'm from in Indiana, you might as well be in Alabama.
Well, that's why I refer to both states as Talibandiana and Talibama.
Right. Well, in my home county, there's a Selma. So, you know, it gets a little weird up there.
Oh, I can imagine. You know, there's a lot of attitudes that are, you know, it's the same attitude, just a different accent.
Yeah. But on the good side, my ex-wife is letting me stay a couple nights with her because she thinks I don't need to be alone right now, so that's good. We delayed our Christmas dinner by a day, so when she gets back from playing poker tonight, we're going to have a rack of ribs that she's slow cooking with in apple cider.
I love the cider trick. That's a great touch.
And you know, pork and apple go together like hand and glove. So.
Exactly.
So, you know, and she has always been one of these old-fashioned cooks that never writes anything down.
Yeah, that just takes too long.
I want to try this, I want to try that, you know. My mom gave a couple of weeks ago when we went to dinner. Gave her all of the family recipes, you know, for chop suey and Frito pie and all the stuff that she made when I was a kid, that made us feel like we were eating high on the hog when it was a couple of cents a serving, you know, that kind of stuff.
Well, that's the best kind of creative culinary skills.
So, and one point in time when my mom was raising us three kids by herself, she was a lunch lady and she would bring the leftovers from school and then dress them up.
Oh, back when the school lunchroom was something more than a couple of microwaves?
Yes. Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, I have a dear friend who cooked in the West Virginia schools at a West Virginia, I think an elementary or middle school, for like 15, 20 years. And, you know, she'd be in the kitchen there at 5 o'clock in the morning rolling out fresh biscuits. And they were the best biscuits to be had in the county, were to be had at that school from her kitchen.
And those were very lucky children.
Yeah, gone are the day.
And let me tell you, all the jokes about the lunch ladies, they were the sweetest women I ever met in my life.
Oh, without a doubt.
Because I know we talk about the little blue-haired old ladies, but they were the original little blue-haired old ladies.
Well, you know, when I talk about the little blue-haired ladies in the Fellowship Hall kitchen, that comes from my past reality. They really were. And mercy sakes alive, I mean, they could cook. Oh, they could cook.
I mean, I grew up the ladies in the parish when I was a kid. You know, if there was a funeral to be had, there was always a meal after the burial. And they brought in homemade stuff from all over, and they'd cook that ham for hours. And that was their way of showing love and support for the people who were grieving, who didn't
right because
really,
grieving people
needed to take care of themselves.
Grieving people don't need to be worrying about cooking. Exactly.
Right.
And you know, that's not a Southern thing. That's just a human thing.
Yeah, I mean, I went to school with kids from the Middle East, and they were like, "Oh, that's common." You know, back home, if there's a death in the family, the neighbors bring the food. You don't cook for 3 or 4 days. You know, you know, we kind of forget that kind of stuff, Bob. You know, in this we're right, they're wrong kind of world, we forget that we have those commonalities.
Hey, well, there's been a lot of effort put into making sure that we forget them, because if there's been a common theme through the rise of right-wing conservatism, say, since 1964, it has been to atomize, if you will, communities, so that we all feel like we live by ourselves and that we have nothing in common, even with our next-door neighbors.
Yeah. And it's like, I have to say, throughout this whole ordeal, the last few months with my mom, my friends, my family, you, others, I can't say how much they have reached out to me, and they've said, take care of yourself, and if you need anything, let us know, and we're thinking about you, and just, it makes me feel good to know that I'm not in it by myself. And I told my sister and brother that if we needed to move stuff around, I had people that could help do that. And it forces me to look at my mom a little differently, because we've never gotten along in the last 25 years. But at this point, we've come to an understanding that I'm not going to crap on her deathbed. And I'm going to get a few questions answered, and she's going to put her mind at rest, and we're going to go from there. So that's what I wanted to call and tell you guys. And I wanted to let you guys know how much I appreciate the horn.
Well, I'm glad you did, and I wish you the very best going through what is an obviously trying time, Dave. And I know that the sense of the entire Horn Family Community Congregation goes with you.
I appreciate that, Bob, and I know it does. And I will send you all the recipes Mom gave me. We ought to put together a little blue-haired old lady cookbook.
Oh, my, that could be something.
Wouldn't it, though?
Oh, yes.
All right, Bob. You have a good New Year's, man, and I'll be listening. And I'm going to help Christine put it in her car when she's delivering pizzas, so you'll be keeping her laughing.
Okay, very good, very good. Dave, a very happy new year to you, and thanks for being part of the community, my friend.
All right, Bob. Thank you. Good night.
Bye now. That's Dave calling from Taliban, Indiana. Let's see. Before we go back to the phones, a quick note, courtesy of Mike in Cascadia. Subject line, Pullman's made it to Cascadia. The Pullman's arrived in this corner of Cascadia this morning. Therefore, when I went home for my lunch break today, I had a tasty Pullman snack. Yep, better than potato chips. Lucky for me, Paul from Parts Unknown is also in Cascadia. So when we secede from the Union, I won't have to pay Trump's Pullman tariff, whereas all you suckers in Red America will have to cough up big money to enjoy Pullman's. So besides weed from San Diego to Vancouver, B.C., we'll have Pullman's. Cheers, Mike in Cascadia. Enjoy in great good health, Mike. Enjoy. Let's see. Rolling along, let's run over to the stress line where I think we got, is that Todd? Hey, Todd.
Hey, man, what's going on?
Hey, how was Christmas dinner?
Oh, it was wonderful. It was wonderful. It was simple and beautiful. know?
Oh, I saw a picture of Tracy standing rib, and it was pretty damned impressive.
Oh my God! Did you see how I saw that? Yes. Did you see how juicy that? I mean, it was perfect because mm-hmm. if you want yeah. it that rare, you got it rare.
Yeah, that wasn't Trump style. That wasn't incinerated.
No, see, it had the charred stuff on the outside for folks who want that. Some people like to chew on that, you know, chew that fat on the outside. Well, I'm getting all. See, you got me talking about the food. I'm getting all excited. Man. Yeah, it was smell-o-vision. I have to say.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I did turkey. Then we had sweet potatoes, nice fresh green beans with fresh mushrooms, just steamed, real simple. Stuffing. I stuffed the turkey with Vidalia onions, various seasonings, and fresh rosemary. Because there's just so much rosemary out there.
Did you brine that sucker?
I did not. I had so much other stuff going. I wanted to, you know, but it turned. I was amazed it turned out okay without brining it. And I didn't even put any water in the pan. And I put water in it at the last minute. During the final stages of the cooking. But yeah, everything came out. You know, it came out fine. You know, it was fine. I would have preferred to have brined it, but I had so many other things to do. There was no way I was going to be able to do that. But, oh my God, it's a shame. I feel guilty because there's so many hungry people and there's always food. You know, it's kind of, but that's okay. The neighbors, my God, I don't think they cook. Some of my neighbors, man, they smell it because I open up the house. You know,
oh, yeah.
You know, you know what I mean?
I do.
So that was a really heartwarming, heartfelt Dave. Wow. The last call.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, Dave's good people.
You know, and Jim. Jim is hanging in there. Jim's hanging in there. You know? But, you know, you guys were talking about the concentration camps, and Jim brought up really something I had been thinking about. You know, now that we know that this whole administration is all about, you know, monetizing things, and they just don't care, all about, you know, whatever Putin wants them to do. I mean, this is the Putin Trump presidency. That's just all there is to it. But how come there's not more of an uproar about this ZTE phone deal? Because that bothers me. Because I'm starting to connect some dots here. Let me just finish this sentence.
Go ahead. I want you to elaborate.
Okay. Because, I remember way back when Obama was about to give over the reins. Remember when he kicked out about 30 operatives who were spies? They were living over in Maryland in some nice, you know, they were allowed to live there. They were quote-unquote diplomats, but they were spies. And they were all asked to leave unceremoniously, get the hell out. And at the same time, it was announced that there was a Russian trawler on the East Coast. And within the same 2 months, there was a big kerfuffle about the prevalence of stingrays in the D.C. area. And stingrays are a fake.
Yeah, you mean those little cell phone interceptors.
Correct. Exactly. Yes, exactly. Right. They're dangerous. They're just so ugly. So, you know, you put all these things together.
And it begins to look like a picture?
Oh, God. It's like being kicked in the stomach repeatedly. It's just too much. And he waves the flag and he's got these people thinking that he's for the troops and all this. The military will not use these phones. And he continues to use an unsecured cell phone, which is what got me on this. When you were talking about the SEAL operatives, right? Remember
yeah.
You just mentioned that? Like, okay. So that kind of is what triggered this. Okay. So what? Am I off the ranch here? What's going on?
I'm hard pressed to give you a credible answer. I mean, because I go to this place that I don't like being in, and that is the idea that the man is an agent of a foreign power, plain and simple. Now he's a dipshit. He's a dipshit, but he's a dipshit agent of a foreign power, and I get that. But, you know, even the Russians are coming to the realization that their master plan may not be quite everything they had hoped it would be, insofar as, pardon me, I'm putting a gas bottle on right now, but I can multitask. But, well, okay, Agnes is here, too. Agnes is doing all the heavy lifting.
Thank you.
But,
I heard her laugh. That's great. That's great.
Oh, her laugh makes flowers bloom. I'm not kidding. It's the sweetest thing in the world.
That's great.
You got brownie points.
But no, he's a foreign agent, and even the Russians are beginning to say, "Hey, you know, maybe this wasn't the best idea we've had in a while," because they realize that he's such a dipshit that you can't count on him for anything. It's not that he won't stay bought. It's just that he is an inveterate, incorrigible fuck-up. I mean,
he's too much of a buffoon. He's given up the goods too easily now.
He could screw up a one-car funeral. But I do have to ask you, because, you know, this is between you and Steve. This is y'all's corner, so I'm not going to infringe.
Oh shit!
Did you catch Washington Journal this morning?
I'm gonna tell you what happened. The damn speakers burned up. Have you heard of spontaneous combustion? That my speakers, the damn ignorance was coming through. So
the stupid shredded your speakers, Todd. Is that what you're telling me?
Listen, I'm going to incorporate that into my radio show. And I don't care if anybody picks up my idea. Now, part of it will be dissecting. I'm not going to use anyone's name. But the shit that I heard this morning, Steve Scully was depressed. Steve was working. He tries to be all nice and shit. You know, he's one of the nicer hosts, and he's very polite. Steve was just like, he sounded so down and out by the end of the show. I hope to God he can show up to work next time.
You think he walked out of there with his little head in his little hands this morning thinking, you know, maybe there's still hope. I could maybe yet be a piano player in a whorehouse.
Oh. And then, Bob, it might have been this morning. I don't know. It's all running together now. I don't know, because sometimes I listen to the podcast. But this one guy was talking about the wetbacks. He just said, oh, yeah, the wetbacks. There is so much hatred and so much, how do I put it? But, yeah, the ignorance. It's just, it's really sad.
Well, I was thinking more along the lines of Scott from New York. Do you know this one?
What time was that? Because I tried to write down. It was so much. One person made sense, but he was from Pleasant.
It was about 9:30-ish this morning.
Mm-hmm.
You got your hockey puck handy?
Yeah, I'm going to need that one.
Yeah, everybody is. So Scott from New York called in support of the Trump shutdown.
Oh, wait a minute. Is this that North America is the best country on the earth?
No.
And this
other guy, and this isn't the guy that I had the other day who supports the Trump shutdown because he's just a hardworking man who didn't go to no liberal arts colleges and lives paycheck to paycheck working with his hands so he can send his children to college.
That motherfucker.
No, this isn't him either.
You know that pissed me off.
For
right?
low,
you know
in Trump's mansion are many maggots. No, this is a prayer meeting. I think they're trying to step on my turf over there at C-SPAN, and there may have to be like a letter written or some such. Because here's Scott from New York, who I might add can't hold a candle to Scott from San Diego. Just want to be sure about that. Yeah. Oh, damn it. I'll get this working yet.
The military has been funded, and the legislative branch, among others, have been funded. Scott is in New York. Good morning.
Yes, good morning. I have a real easy solution, but I'm in support of it because I'm waiting for the second coming. We just celebrated the first coming of Jesus, but Jesus is coming back. In this craziness the government is just getting us closer. Now, a solution to having the illegals pay for the wall. Trump can do this by going after every business in America that got a tax break. If they have any ties to any sister, baby companies, also them, that have hired any illegal alien in the past, we take that tax break back, which is basically the taxpayers' money that we're giving these people to commit crimes as far as hiring.
Yeah, so hold on, because there's video that goes with this. And at one point, dude reaches under the desk, and I halfway expect him to pull up a 1.75 of Jack Daniels and just rip that little pouring thing out of it and just tip it up. Todd, he takes a moment there, and he just kind of, oh, wait, hang on. Hang on, Todd. Don't go anywhere. Bluetooth dropped. God only knows why that happens, but this is too important to... Stand by, Todd. Okay. All right, you're back. I don't know when you lost it. Did you actually get the clip?
I did, and no, I heard it. I heard it this morning, and he was all... That's what I'm saying. I lost track this morning because it distilled all the ignorance into one show today. But yes, I remember that. I remember that. I was
because
like, what?
That right there is, I mean, I gotta agree with, that is some speaker shredding stupid.
Today was the banner day. Like, I have to really, I'm gonna put that shit on my calendar. This is, I'm telling you, part of my show, I'm gonna read news, and I'm gonna dissect some of these calls, because see, then the Washington Journal's never going away.
You could probably make a living out of that.
And that's not my, you know, that's not really what I want to do at all. But, you know, my better half, she told me that, you know, I need to get started on this and you know, we've got some other stuff going on. But she, I'm almost speechless. That's what I'm saying. So I'm so glad you brought that up. And I hope Steve in Georgia, I know he was listening this morning, but it was breathtaking. So what kind of logic, see, this is what I'm saying. What are we going to do with these folks?
Well, all you can do is try to muddle through despite them, not with them. They're never going to be with us. They're never going to want to build a better America. They just want an America that's, you know, white enough to make them feel somewhat secure. You know, I had a note just a few minutes ago from Lee in New York, Todd, and going back to me talking about Trump being a fuckwit. Lee in New York says, subject line, useful idiot. The problem with employing a useful idiot is that the person is still an idiot. And that's absolutely true. And that, you know, like attracts like.
Right.
Because this guy is, you know, Scott from New York, who's waiting for the second coming of Jesus. Well... You know, he's just spending his life as part of the 2,000 years that, or, well, okay, 1970 or 1980 or whatever, that all the rest of the, any minute now, going to be here any minute, yep. But he wasn't done. You know, he was talking about these illegal aliens. You know. Just a reminder, there's a hell of a lot more to New York than that incredibly cosmopolitan city down in the southeast corner of the state. Just saying.
Oh, they're an outlier, to use a statistical term.
Yeah, so here we go. I hope. Come on.
These illegals, we take that tax break back and we could build us a golden wall across both the Mexican and the Canadian border. I want it to shut down because I can't wait for when Jesus comes back and gets the righteous real people and takes them to heaven, and then we have a real big mess on this earth. And we're getting...
Got your point, Scott. To Bill in Erie, Pennsylvania. Good morning.
Hey, good morning. Happy New Year to everybody. Listen, this country takes...
And that's pretty much the end of it. You know, Bill wasn't talking about a race of men in the trees or anything. So, but dude here, did you notice? He's not happy with a big golden wall across Mexico. He wants one on the Canadian border, too.
That's it.
Whew.
I don't understand. You know, I remember, last time we talked, you brought up an author. And it shocked me that was talking about anti-intellectualism, and it was so before I thought that was even a term.
Oh, Richard Hofstadter.
Mm-hmm. Hofstadter, early 60s. I think he said 63, something like that.
Yeah.
And that shit frightened me, but I guess I shouldn't be frightened anymore. You know, it is what it is.
Well, I mean, if you're in a swamp and you know, I mean, because this is. You can probably identify with this, you know, South Carolina. And all. If you're in a swamp in a certain part of the world where venomous snakes are fairly common, then you have a right to, I mean, you can be scared of the water moccasins because they're mean as shit, but the best thing you can do is be aware that you are in water moccasin country and act accordingly. Mm-hmm. Well, we're in, I mean... A third, you know, of the people who voted in the last election have stayed with this idiot through thick and thin.
And they're going to continue to
And they're not going to, and that's, I mean, that's me getting, they're trying to get to your point, Todd. They're not going anywhere, and they're not going to leave him. And so whatever we do, we have to do without them. We have to do despite them. And this pipe dream that comes from a certain political sector that says, oh, well, you know, we can bring the maggots back over our side if we just tell them.
Who says that?
Don't make me get the hateful emails, please.
No, I'm serious.
No,
that's
please.
Bullshit.
No, that, well, there's
no,
just.
I'm not trying to mess with you, man. I'm serious. Because that's asinine. Who says that?
Well, there's a school of political thought that says that, gosh, it, you know, that it's the neoliberals who ruined everything and they just don't understand the economic anxiety of the heartland white people. And
oh, fuck. Okay.
And if you think about it, and you save me from having to get the hateful emails, then I'll thank you. But it'll come to you, Todd. It'll come to you.
Mm-hmm.
Because, but the thing is, there's no political theory that brings the Scott in New York's of the world back over to the Democratic fold. Because, one, he was probably never there in the first place. And, two, he's just waiting for Jesus to come and take him up so they got ringside seats to watch everything go to hell down here.
Well, I don't... Right, so... I've given up on that anyway.
Some of the stuff, I mean, Jack in Shreveport says, Scott's call, what the fuck does Scott need with a wall if he's going to be raptured up all anyway?
Well, that's the whole thing. Their whole mindset is not logical. And then when you present them with a logical argument, their eyes just glass, glass over. They can't respond because there's no correct response. there's not a credible response.
But by the same token, then this is kind of more in your bailiwick. Consider, we don't have conversations about what happens on Washington Journal when some perfectly reasonable person calls up. We have conversations about what happens when Scott calls up, who wants a wall to save us from the, you know, to help Jesus get. You see what I mean?
Right. Well, there's so few and far between. And this is what, you know what?
Okay, let me ask you. I mean, this is your corner. So are there a hell of a lot more Scott from New York's than there are normal people calling that program?
Yes, and this is what, and you know what, yes. And I'm going to tell you, I've been thinking about, you asked me a question last time we talked about average. And I was like, you know, I don't think I answered you appropriately. But this is what I'm saying is that, so this is a self-selected crowd. Now, they sound like they're likely voters, and I believe they're motivated people. But we know that. They're motivated. Now, we can't assume that they all vote. But I would, most of them probably vote. Because if you go to listen to Washington Journal, some of these folks are just homebound and they have nothing else to do and they're up all the time. I get that. I'm disabled. But when we look at the Trump phenomenon, we have to select out all the other variables, right? That's what you do in statistics. You select out the things that you know, so you can figure out what the truth is. So back to what you said about, like, middle America folk. Now, we have selected out all the other variables. They are the only ones who won't just say Trump is our great white hope. And that's what it comes down to. There's nothing left. He's incompetent. He's mentally ill. And you know, all right. And he is a narcissistic sociopath, which is a terrible combination. Plus, he has other shit going on. And I'm just saying this from someone who has a degree in psychology and who was certified to work with human and animal subjects. And I have worked on research projects with Alzheimer's and dementia. And he cannot pass the puff test. I can tell you right now. Why is we have all this corroborating information? All these books. They might be salacious. They might be bullshit. These people are mercenaries. But guess what? They all say the same thing, don't they? Everyone calls him an idiot. Everyone says, I think he might even have dyslexia or he doesn't want to wear glasses. But most children, when you teach, when they don't want to read, there's a reason. Either the words are moving around in their mind, they have ADD, dyslexic, or, you know, a combination of all three. Who knows? But there's so much shit going on with this person. I know I'm going off in a tangent, but it's just too much. Now, what is going on behind the scenes? Who is really running the country? That's what we need to be asking.
That's a Jim Dandy question, Todd. It really is. So, I mean,
think about it.
No, if you ask the people who pick their teeth with their toenail clippings, they'll tell you the deep state's doing all that. Deep state's running. That's why they don't like Trump, because he's getting in the way of the deep state. Right?
Okay. Right. You're absolutely correct. Right. But that's not logical, but yes, they'll say that.
Meanwhile, people like, say, Steve Mnuchin, what's he do? He sends the markets into a panic by saying that something prevention force has been.
Why did you have to bring that up?
Well, I'm sorry.
No, I'm serious. That's some fucked up shit. We should never breathe another word of that. You should never ask major banks if they're liquid when the stock market is jumpy and has diarrhea.
Yeah. Hey, it's Treasury Secretary Steve. Just wanted to check. Y'all still have money, right? Right. You don't need my wife and me to go and run off a few thousand sheets of hundreds, do you? She likes to go down to the mint and the printing presses. She enjoys that a lot. Yeah.
What is going on here?
We don't know, and the election is 22 months away.
Well, let me ask you a question. Now, it does appear that it appears that almost every decision that's being made on an international scale. And let's go back. Wait, let me say this first, because you hit the nail on the head way early in terms of the concentration camps with the children. The day before, and you were the only one who said this, and no one else has talked about it. Remember, the UN pulled out, the United States with the UN, we pulled out of an agreement about crimes, not war crimes, but crimes against children or something, right before they instituted that policy of caging children. Do you remember that?
Yep.
So this was programmed. This was a plan. See, this was a plan. So we got to look at these contracts. And speaking of contracts, who's got this contract for the wall? This wall shit. See, I don't. You know, we have to understand what this guy is.
Well, he claimed he's a parasite.
He
claimed that he had let contracts for wall building in Texas that he legally can't even do. I mean, it was just an outright lie.
But that's what I'm saying. That's what his mindset is. I want this money. You see, he doesn't want any money to flow through the government without him getting his piece of it, because that's his mindset. Because he's a parasite. He's a sociopath.
Well, and he's also a wannabe mobster, and he wants his vig. He wants to wet his beak.
He can't stand it. All right. Now, when this new Congress comes in, when the House comes in, and we're already controlling the money, and he can't stand that, but he doesn't understand government.
Well, the list of things he doesn't understand is a hell of a lot longer than the list of things that he does, Todd. I mean, that's a fact.
I know, and I'm all over the place.
No, you're not all over the place, but what I started the program with is, again, something that you're probably not going to hear anybody talking about anywhere else. And that is the fact that the disease bearers aren't the people coming from down there. The disease bearers are the people who are already here. And what if that becomes, I mean, the reason that Kirstjen Nielsen said, I'm going to have all the children examined. Well, I'm sure she thinks it's because, like Tucker Carlson said, immigration makes us a dirtier country. But she's got some bass-ackward notion that they're bringing the disease here when walking for 1,000 miles, they would probably show symptoms somewhere along the way, as opposed to the ordinary incubation time of cold and flu and things like that, which is seldom more than the 6 days that poor boy had been in custody.
I would venture to guess that those folks are healthier than most Americans. Number one, they're coming from where
I can't walk 1,000 miles.
Can you? That's what I'm saying. They're used to eating good foods, and they come from places, even though their governments are jacked up because of us, because we're old enough to remember Danny Ortega and us messing. You know, we mess up, but we don't clean up. You know, this goes back to Ollie North and the Contras and all that nonsense, you know, and the Boland Amendment. So, you know, folks need to look a little bit of history. But they have socialized, when the government does work, they have socialized medicine. Those folks had better health care than most of us have, or they had it. People go to Mexico to get their teeth worked on.
It reminds me of a clip from one of my favorite films, The Lion in Winter. Check out Catherine Hepburn delivers the line. Check this out.
We are the killers. We breed wars.
Ta-da.
Can you do that one more time, please?
Absolutely. Happy to.
We are the killers. We breed wars.
That says it all. Well,
and 500, hey, it's like 500 years didn't even happen. But, you know, the ultimate irony, Tenochtitlan was the biggest city in the world in 1491, or in 1518 before they got, it was the largest city in the world. And now it is, again, It only took 500 years.
Pretty sad.
Only problem is, it's not the sustainable city that it once was. There are horrible problems with things like fresh potable water in Mexico City that they that the indigenous people didn't have 500 years ago.
You know, it's fascinating when you look at the history, how they worked with the land there, and they had these floating patches of earth, and they would have their crops just on these floating patches of reeds and
earth. The Chinampas.
Yeah. You know, I mean, come on. You know, I always wanted to go to the Guatemalan Highlands, and a group of us, we were going to go down there and eat mushrooms for a few years and just kind of drop out. It wasn't a good time. But, you know, I don't know. I don't know what's going to happen, because these folks are dug in. And, oh, by the way, have you seen this rural news network like OAN and...
One America News, I've run across it a couple of times. It makes Fox News it look like a bastion of liberalism. Yeah. Hey, I got to share something real quick, courtesy of Cynthia. Cynthia just wrote and said, just jumped in a moment before I have to take off, but Trump is a psychopath, too. I swear he's a psychopath. Anybody who says I could shoot somebody in the middle of Fifth Avenue and never lose a vote, that's a guy who's thought about shooting somebody in the middle of Fifth Avenue and whether it would affect his ability to get votes. So, yeah, that kind of does point toward psychopath.
Well, right. Well, that's the line. That's the difference. You know, the physical violence. You know, and you know, I'm looking back, and you know, we used to think it was funny, but let's look back to the day after the inauguration. Like, I don't know if you've ever been given a presentation. You know, you have some graphs and charts, and take them to Kinko's, and go down to the university copy shop, and they put it on a nice piece of poster board, like in Congress, nice and light, but it's tight. You know, and the pixel's really tight, so everybody can see it. So he did that with both of those pictures, right? His inauguration and Obama's. And it was just clear to everyone, you know, which crowd was larger. But he insisted his crowd was larger. So he's constructing his own reality. Now, we thought it was funny then, like, well, he's just being, you know, Trump. You know, no. Well, he's being Trump, but, you know, Trump is delusional. That's what I'm saying. He's on the far end of that spectrum. So I don't know. I think something may happen. He's going to pop. It's just too much pressure. You know, it's just too much going on now. He's going to have to, between the Adderall, his drug abuse, it appears, because that was freaky. Wasn't that crazy? We were talking about him snorting Adderall. Then I'm listening to Jeff Lentz, and I hear this comic talk about it. Then on the front porch a couple weeks ago or last week or whatever, then you guys start talking about it. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do. I do.
So, so once again, we have to worry about who is really running the country. Now, it could be the good guys, it could be the bad guys. But, you know, I have a theory it could be bigger than all of it. This whole thing could be a big setup. Because think about it. We had this backlash. The folks had to know. The whole thing is rigged, number one, anyway. Because we have two private organizations that you have to go through to be president. They're not public entities. They're private organizations. They're private clubs. And if they don't want you in the club, you're not in. And you won't be on the ballot. So that's the first layer of corruption that you got to get through. So that being said, and then, you know, then all the way to the end point is the Electoral College. And they knew this guy was unfit, but they let him through anyway. So, you know, what's really going on here? Because now we have all this upheaval. You know, what's going on? Why wages are depressed? We have there's all this supposed money. Stock market was at 24,000, 25,000. Why do we have all these communities with $10 an hour scales of wages? That makes no sense.
Well, it doesn't make any sense in a country that cares about the working class. It makes perfect sense. In an oligarchy that is only concerned with the well-being of a tiny handful of revoltingly wealthy people.
But this can't go on because there's too many people now with too much
it's
money.
Unsustainable. Yes, it absolutely is. There's no doubt about it.
It just worries me. I think we have to figure out another way to survive because something has to give. Because now, you know, and think about it. Now with the technology, we don't need as many workers as we used to. So are we gonna have to get people just a stipend to live on and maybe have Luddite communities where people can just pursue their interests and be fully actualized, as Maslow would say? Or, you know, because we had to think about this. You know how in some Star Trek episodes they would go to these different planets and people would just be in simple clothes, just kind of rough-hewn clothes and living in just wooden structures and whatnot?
Right.
You know, and I mean, there's technology out there, but they live simply. So I don't know. Something's got to give soon. I don't know what the hell's going on. And before you let me go, I want to say this. I want to ask you something. Now, I don't know if you keep track of what's going on in space. But
some here and there. But, yeah.
Okay. So, you know, we'll find out more and more. And there's this Nibiru thing on the internet that's been out there for a number of years. And, you know, some folks say it's credible. Some folks don't. But the folks who say it's credible say one of the monikers will be you'll see more meteor showers, asteroids, and because of the gravitational pull, because it's like a series of planets and asteroids that are on this long loop that go around our solar system and come around Earth every, like, I don't know, 3,000 years or something like that. But because of the gravitational pull, it disrupts the magma in our planet and causes more earthquakes and volcano eruptions. And when Krakatoa erupted the other day, I don't know.
Noticed that, did you?
Man, listen, you're probably like me. I mean, in school, when I learned, you know, in history class, whatever, you know, social studies, that shit freaked me out. I was like, there was a winter for a whole year or two, like from a fucking volcano. That shit freaked me out.
Yeah, and this was like little baby Krakatoa. But hey, here's another fun one. There was a let's see here, let me find it. There was a 4.8 quake near Mount Etna in Sicily.
Mm.
That's the most active volcano in Europe, Mount Etna. And that was early today.
Oh, shit.
Some old buildings got damaged. 4 people were injured. But Mount Etna is not too terribly far from Vesuvius.
Wasn't that Pompeii?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And it's due.
But what's going on with Mount St. Helens?
I haven't seen a lot of Mount St. Helens stuff lately.
We remember that. Remember people were collecting that dust and all over the place?
Oh, yeah.
Well, Bob, I'm glad you're upright. And I'm glad you didn't have to get new tires.
Oh, I can't tell you how glad I was not to get new tires. Dear God. So, I mean, eventually I will, but hopefully I can put another couple of thousand or 3,000 miles on these things and get them to, say, May, which will be their second anniversary.
Mm-hmm.
Because I priced them while I was there, and I'll never buy these tires again, but these tires there are $150 a skin.
That's a lot.
Yeah.
It hurts.
Oh, it does. Depending on who you listen to, you either do 2 or 4 at a time, but they've got to pretty much match. And
you won't like it. If you have a newer vehicle, you're asking for trouble.
Well, it's the all-wheel drive thing that gets you there. Gets you in trouble because I guess if you've got different tread depths and stuff, you'll eventually screw up your transfer case.
You don't want to do that.
No, I sincerely do not want to do that. I need this car to go for a long, 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 long time. But it was a great relief not to. Oh, and I've had a couple of I can report some food porn successful experiments.
Oh.
I made two. Let's just call them for shorthand. I made two stinky cheese experiments. I mentioned it the other night. I made one Czech style beer cheese and a German style beer cheese, and they're both wonderful. Beer cheese. You take cheese and then you add stuff to it until you get something else. And the Czech style, they said, well, you're not going to get what they use, so start with cottage cheese. Well, next time I do it, I will have the common sense to set up the cottage cheese so that it strains through cheesecloth for a longer period of time and we get all the moisture out of it. And then you mm-hmm. add in the ground caraway seed and the, whatever else went in there, onion. But you pack it away in a mason jar and you just leave it at room temperature for a week. And it starts getting funky.
I was about to say, that shit might explode.
And then you spread it on, like, thin slices of rye or pumpernickel. Yeah.
Mmm.
The German style is a lot stronger. And it's sitting here. It's sitting here getting funky, too, but it's made out of sharp and mild cheddar. And to have that cocktail rye they put out for the holidays?
Sure.
The little tiny squares, and you just maybe toast one side. Oh, it's yummy. You know, just smear, bite, beer, and it's happy snacking.
Yeah, it costs a lot to make that rye bread. There's a reason it costs more. That flour, it's just the flour alone. You know, it's a whole different ballgame. That's real bread. When you get rye, you're dealing with real bread. That's like that soap I like. That's real soap.
Oh, Dr. Bronner's?
Other shit.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, not Dr. Bronner's, but the other one. Right. Dr. Bronner's is great, but I'm talking about the cake soap, Kirk's.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, okay.
Man, I'm telling you, anyone use one of those, I used to think they were corny, but it's like a little, you know, the nylon scrubber you use for pots, but it's for your body?
Yeah.
You know, women use it. Man, I'm telling you, that shit works. I don't care what it looks like.
Oh, I love those things, and it goes, a long, long time ago, there was a hell of a fine running back came out of Pittsburgh, out of Pitt, and his name was Craig Ironhead Hayward. And unfortunately, both his life and his career were cut short. But they signed him up to do maybe Dove body wash or whatever. Mm-hmm. And with this beautiful innocence in his voice, he holds up that thing that you're talking about, that net scrubber, and he goes,
"Yes."
He goes, "What's this floopy thing?" And that thing, and those have forever been, forevermore been floopies in our household.
Floopy.
Floopy.
All right.
Yeah, yeah. And
well, all I'm saying is that when you combine that with Kirk's, because that's the only soap I use, but, man, the lather is just unbelievable. And then you get the exfoliating.
Oh,
you get
vigorous. You're taking a couple of layers off.
Dude, I need that, man. Look, I'm down here with all these insects, man. I can't walk 10 feet in this yard without getting bit by something. You don't want to know. You know what? The problem with your show is that you talk about too many different things.
I'll take that into account. I'll try to be a little more single-minded.
Now, I know. You know me. Come on, man. You know I'm being funny. I'm trying to be funny.
I know.
But you didn't laugh.
No, I was smiling vigorously here. I was still thinking about the floopy.
I was shocked. I was like, the Kirk's already gives you, like I was telling you, because I have to shave, you know, I have a bald head, so I have to shave every day. And it's a lot of suds from that soap, but when you combine it with that floopy, oh my God, it's just unreal. It's like, man, I could turn off the water, right, and do the Navy shower, you know, you lather up.
Yeah.
No, if you want to save water. Wow.
So, do you use that curved razor thing that they make for doing your head?
No.
It like follows the curve of your skull?
You know what? I haven't gone that far yet. No, I've got an adept. I just kind of the trick is just do it every day, because if you don't, it's a problem. It's a real man.
You know, I've thought about doing that a few times, because you know it's getting thin, and it's particularly thin, you know, way up top in the middle. And and then it occurs to me, no, Bob, don't do that. You'll have third-degree fucking radiation burns on the top of your head. Because,
yeah,
little pink me, you know?
You might not be a good candidate right now.
Yeah, I think I'm...
Think about it.
And I don't think it would make me, like, look cool. I would just look like me with a pink head.
You know what? When I went to work, I was still working at the university, and I just did it over the weekend, and I walked in, and everybody just, it got quiet. The whole floor just got quiet. They thought I had lost my mind. I was like, no, I'm good. Except for one of the secretaries, and then we're still friends. I put it like that. But, you know, she knows my better half. We're all friends, whatever. But, I wish I had been, you know what, I don't miss my hair at all. I wish I had done this shit when I was 20, man. I ain't lying. Because, you know, it's easy when you wake up, man. It's easy to wash.
Zit, 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 zit. And, yeah.
It's funny. So listen, what kind of leftovers do you have now? What are you munching on?
Nothing. We've just been we've been noshing steadily along, and now I'm making preservations, as the saying goes, for the New Year's Day meal. By the way, Jimmy just wrote in, said, living in Seattle, Mount St. Helens doesn't bother me. It's Mount Rainier. So just food for thought. Now I've turned my attentions to New Year's Day and brisket on the acorn and corned beef and cabbage. And I started thinking, hey, what if I was to cut that cabbage in hemispheres and grill the face of the cabbage, the flat face of the cabbage, before I took it all apart and put it into steam with the corned beef juices?
I would do that. I would roll that in seasoned oil. You know, like pick a large bowl and put some oil in it, some seasoning, and get it all coated, and grill it.
Yeah, and then after it's all nice and grilly, hit it with a little bit of salt, and squeeze a half a lemon over all of it.
Man,
I just happen to have the lemons for the job.
You know what? Good food never gets old, does it?
Oh no, it doesn't. And get a big pot of turnip greens going, and slow cooker the Hoppin' John with the black eyed peas.
Oh, you know what? I think I was born to eat black eyed peas. They taste like meat to me.
I love them. They've got an earthy quality that other beans don't have.
That's the word. I'm sorry. Yes.
Yeah.
You get me excited. Earthy. You know you're eating something. Like, my tongue says, oh, this is healthy. This is good for you, and it tastes good.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. God. I mean, there's a lot more substantial flavor there than, say, in a pinto.
Well, yeah, pintos have their place. But, you know, man, when you hook up some black-eyed peas, when you talk about that Hoppin' John, oh.
Yeah, see, black-eyed peas and rice and celery and onions and a little seasoning. Go, man, you know.
You can live on that. Well, I appreciate the conversation. I guess somebody else is trying to call in. There's so much. I'm just concerned with... You know, I don't know what.
Well, no. I mean, it's not just you, because everybody. I think even the maggots, to a certain extent, Todd, are waiting for the other shoe to drop. And we don't know what form or shape it's going to take. We know that. Even with this alleged trip to Iraq, and of course, I love that, because the standard, the bullshit we're supposed to accept is that President and Mrs. Trump left Washington, D.C. late Christmas night. Bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
There was a photograph of Air Force One flying over England early this afternoon our time. Well, if you leave the United States late Christmas night, you're going to be over England by about 7 a.m.
It takes 7 hours to get from New York to London. Around, I think. I mean, that's when I did it. It was around 7. I don't know.
And so,
is that what you're saying?
Yeah. So, it couldn't have left earlier than, say, 5 or 6 o'clock this morning. But then he gets over to Iraq, and again, he fucks up. Or he doesn't fuck up, because he just goes over there and starts telling whoppers to the troops. He went over there and said, I just wanted to let you know I've given you your first pay raise in 10 years. No, actually, the quote was, you haven't gotten a raise in more than 10 years, and we got you a big one. I got you a big one. Well, the problem is, the military has gotten a pay increase, with the exception of 1983, every year. And in particular, the military pay went up 2.8% in 2018, and then another 2.6% in the National Defense Authorization Act. He went on, Julius Geezer did, and said, you had plenty of people that came up and said, we can make it smaller. I said, no, make it 10%. Make it more than 10%, because it's been a long time. And they're just outright lies. It's not like one of those things where reasonable minds can differ or it's a matter of interpretation. No, these are outright lies. And then he does that thing that I mentioned earlier, talking with Jim, where he outs SEAL Team 5.
Well, he did what?
He outed SEAL Team 5's clandestine top secret, double secret probation location.
With his unsecured phone. I can't get over this shit. I'm sorry. This is unacceptable behavior. And see, this is so beyond political party. And I just get very irritated when I hear these maggots talk about, well, you just saw because Hillary lost. Nobody gives a damn about that fucking woman. I'm sorry. This has nothing to do. This has to do with right and wrong and the stability of the world. The one thing that America is known for is being stable. Okay? Now, everything is jacked up. Everything. If this man is not a Russian agent, he is doing by default everything that a Russian operative would direct a Russian agent to do that has been compromised. I don't know how to say that any more clearer than that. I mean, I'm just trying to look at this in a clinical type of way. There's no politics involved. Look at the facts. The cabinet, they started presidenting. Before the inauguration, Flynn and Kushner were going back and forth to Russia. And they were going all over the place, China, Russia, setting up. People were like,
don't forget Michael Cohen's goings and comings.
And Michael Cohen in Prague, right? In Prague. All over the place. And people just fluffed it off like, they're just getting set up. And, nobody wanted to really say anything. Well, we're just going to let them, we'll let them pass at that. So, okay. It's like boiling the frog in the water. But now we have to connect all these data points. This, be clinical about this shit. I get emotional. It's easy to get emotional. But I can get clinical also. I have to be. When I'm on the job. This is bullshit. People need to look at the facts. Like you said, the man, he released secrets in the Oval Office with agents. He had no one around that was representing us. He had a Russian agent in the Oval Office at one point. He released documents that were sensitive at the time. Then they retroactively declassified them. Am I mischaracterizing this?
No, that's the thing. You're not.
So this just kind of fucking me up.
I mean, we should all be very, very afraid. We are lit. All he needs is a little fucking khaki suit, and he'd be just like one of these African dictators after the vacuum of the European oppressors left, you know, taking on the worst attributes of the European oppressors.
Right,
you know,
and one of the most disturbing things that's out there right now is the fact that, I don't know if you've seen this or not, but the saber-rattling going on in Ukraine, the Russian, the Russians are planting disinformation in the media saying that the Ukrainians are in possession of and getting ready to use chemical weapons.
That's the setup.
Well, that's the same line of bullshit that came out of the days and weeks immediately before the Panzers rolled across Poland in 1939. They claimed that the Poles had been aggressive to the Germans, which, of course, they hadn't. But then there's Todd, then there's Poland itself, and I've got a story here about a fascist wingnut named Stefan Molyneux, who has viewers of some sort. Let's see if this thing... Yeah, just check this audio out.
Mm-hmm. I've always been skeptical of the ideas of white nationalism, of identitarianism, and white identity. However, I am an empiricist, and I could not help but notice that I could have peaceful, free, easy, civilized, and safe discussions in what is essentially an all-white country. The monoculture that has survived from the Middle Ages through the Renaissance, through the Enlightenment, through the Industrial Revolution, into the 21st century in Poland is something to be treasured, respected, admired, and protected. Second thing I got from Poland is that the view of Poland from outside Poland, the ideological view, the leftist view, the collectivist view, that they're all Nazis and fascists and xenophobes and white nationalists and so on, is not only false, is not only wrong factually, it's wrong morally. These are good, decent people who love their country and have suffered enormously to retain its integrity, and they should be celebrated and honored, not slandered, for some obscure, nefarious political purpose. That is wrong. The Poles are not guilty. And guilt has been so infused into the hearts and minds of Europeans and of whites that to see a shame-free and guilt-free culture, a resilient, strong culture that is resisting collectivism, is something that moved me more than I can probably ever express, but I...
We'll leave him at there, but, yeah, he's... The nasty little Nazis and skinheads and racists in this country, and others as well, Todd, have developed a real crush on Poland, because Poland is enjoying, if you can use that word, engaged in a right-wing, fascistic renaissance of sorts.
And Poland, I don't know if it ever went away. And Czechoslovakia, too. But Poland, yeah, especially. You know, when the old Soviet Union fell, there was a lot of discord. And you know, people were angry, they were poor. Remember, they started rationing toilet paper and vodka. And you know, folks are angry. And a lot of folks never recovered because of the oligarchy. You know, they're gangsters. They skim the money off the top. It doesn't leave a lot for the regular people. I know, I'm just stating the obvious. But, yeah.
And referring to Poland as an all-white nation... I'm pretty sure Poland isn't all white. And, of course, to the extent that there is a lack of ethnic diversity in Poland, There was a little dust-up that started back in, again, 1939 that resulted in a lot of people that white folks weren't too crazy about, well, being sent to the showers and machine-gunned and incinerated. And, you know, and
Bob, you're painting a picture here. Now, this is what I'm seeing. Now, you start off with Putin, right? So now we have to just, like you said, we have to face facts. The president of our country is compromised, and if he's not a Russian agent, he is thoroughly compromised to do the bidding of his operators, who are from the Eastern Bloc, you know, the former Eastern Bloc. And that's just the facts. That's where the facts point. The words may not be there, but the facts point to that. So what does that really mean?
Well, it means that I'd say there's a better than even chance of some serious, as if it weren't already serious, some serious shit going down in Ukraine. We know that there have been Russian troops there for years now. They've been documented. Some of them even operate outside an official uniform. But Vlad wants Ukraine back in his tender mercies.
That's exactly what I thought you were going to say. See, Trump has opened the door now. He's softened up the belly. Now Putin is going to get what he wants, is that warm water port in Crimea.
There we go.
So he can have everything he needs there. So what was going to happen? That's going to happen. Because we can see what's going to happen now. He started.
Understand one other little piece of real estate has always been way, way, way up on the wish lists of Mother Russia. And that is to have control of the Bosporus and the Dardanelles and have a constant, unlimited access and domination over access to the Mediterranean from the Black Sea. A warm, a 365-day-a-year warm water port. And so now, with it looking like there's no small amount of coziness between, strange bedfellows and all that, the Turks want to wipe out the Kurds and don't particularly care what happens in Syria as long as there's not a big spillover into Turkey. On the other hand, Vlad would like to have absolute control of the straits there between the technical demarcation between Europe and Asia.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, the Turks got control of that in May of 1453 by conquering Constantinople.
Man, we're on the same page. Yep. Yep.
I mean, there's... And can you imagine? Can you imagine even trying to explain a tenth of this to an incurious, ignorant man like Donald Trump?
This is what I don't. Well, wait a minute. This is what I don't. See, I'm so glad you brought. Man, that's what I'm saying. That's why I love talking with you, man. My God, you brought this right where. This is like one of the main things anyone who paid attention to in history class. That little piece of land where Turkey is, that's the gateway to the East. That is the magical piece of property. That's one of the magical pieces of property on the planet. And we have a huge base there, but this motherfucker has been duplicitous since day one. I'm talking about Erdogan. Because ISIS has been running back and forth over those borders all through the war. He cannot be trusted. And like you said, he had... And you know what really pissed me off? I've been right on that fucking spot where those people were beating people up in D.C. You know, and that's just like, he knew, in other words, he was just swinging his dick. He was like, okay, I got this. I know I can do whatever I want in the United States now. Because Donald Trump's not saying anything about it. That's some fucked up shit.
Yeah, in a word.
Am I overreacting?
No, you aren't. That's the whole thing. You aren't.
But do the maggots understand any of this shit?
No. There's lots of people who understand these things far better than you or I do. But in some instances, their perceptions are corrupted by the needs of capitalism. In other instances, their perceptions are corrupted by, well, defense contractors. But or of generally, you know, military culture. But the bottom line is that it doesn't matter what's impacting anybody else's perceptions. Whatever those perceptions are untransmittable to Donald Trump. Period.
Okay. All right. So we had to go. You had to bring it back to him because he has no clue. Because like you said, he's incurious and he's just not. He's learning disabled, man. He's not going to get any better. It's just going to get worse with him. So.
And by the way, James just pointed out something. Hitler managed to split France during the war. Partisans fought their own government while we fought the French in North Africa. Do we want Putin to do the same to us? It could happen. Because that's one of the essential divide and conquer.
What else? We're plunging into regionalism, right, as we speak. As we speak. I live here. You live in this. Come on, man. These people are not, they're not having this shit. Do you understand we have at least two arms manufacturers in this state? They make heavy artillery down to handguns. One of them is Palmetto Armory. The other, I don't know what the other. Look, these people are seceding in a minute. They're just waiting. They don't give a fuck. I'm just saying what I see. And what I hear, I'm serious. You know, and the guy over there at Fort Jackson, the commander, he's on the wrong side. He's on the wrong side. He lives around here. He's on the wrong side. That's a major base. I don't trust him.
Yep. Well, it's time for us to get out of here, Todd.
Okay. I understand. And I'm glad you ate well. I'm glad you're getting new people in. And take care.
All right. I will. You have yourself a wonderful evening, and maybe we'll talk again before the New Year's. If not, be safe on amateur night, and Happy New Year to you.
All right.
All right. Later, Todd. Bye now. Our buddy Todd calling from South Carolina, Stan. It is time to get out of here. Thanks, everybody, for joining in this evening. Thanks again to our subscribers, and thanks again to Joanne. Thank you very, very kindly. Back tomorrow for Thorn in the Side Thursday. Thanks to our all-volunteer staff. Thank you to Sparky in the chat room this evening, and Steve. Thank you to our news ninjas. Thank you, Brother Deacon Asa, HeadOn.live. Thank you kindly, John Fox in Australia. Thank you, Ben Birch, WhiteRoseSociety.org. Thanks to the hardest working, bravest people I know, the men and women of Coal River Mountain Watch, CRMW.net. And by the way, let me mention this on the way out the door. We're not doing fundraising for the Horn this week, but I will tell you that there is a fundraiser going on for Coal River Mountain Watch, specifically to enable work to be done to advance the AIC Act. Now, this is going to be the first time the AIC Act will have been introduced in a Congress that has Democratic control. We have a greater chance now than we have ever had to pass it through the House. What we've got to do, though, is be able to be there. Coal River Mountain Watch for the AIC campaign is trying to raise something on the order of $20,000. There's a link for it. If you scroll down my Facebook page, you'll find it. It's over at the AIC Act page as well. And since we're not doing fundraising this week, any help getting toward that fundraising goal is big help. Because we can't, we've learned over the years that we cannot count on like the big greens and whatnot to get this job done. Because they weren't even the ones who came up with the idea of the AIC Act. We were told well, you know, you don't really want one of those things. We know better than you. And so we went and did it anyway. And so starting in this coming new Congress, we're going to have to be able to be in D.C. To make the required pitches and make the necessary requests and build awareness of what this bill is and can do. So during the remainder of the week, I'm going to be asking people to go over, and I'll try to repost over on my Facebook page the AIC Act fundraiser. And also, you can always just go to crmw.net, use the PayPal button, and in the memo, this is very important, put in support for AIC, A-C-H-E. If you can do that, it'll be huge. And of course, thanks always. Gina, it's all for you. Later, y'all.